I hope that you're going to enjoy our session this morning. In fact, I'm confident you will. And it's my real pleasure and privilege to introduce to you Mr. Francis Van Balen. He's a Belgian national, but he's lived in Thailand since 6 years, okay. And he's involved with the minerals extraction and processing industries. He's the chief executive officer, director of the board of many companies in Thailand and Singapore. And I'm sure this morning you're going to really, really enjoy his presentation, okay? And during his presentation, I hope you'll sort of jot down some questions that you'd like to ask him at the end of his presentation, so that you can really learn from his wealth of experience. Okay, now his resume is very extensive. It's just over a page, but like he's got numerous degrees. I think the first one was from a university in Belgium, yes. University of Leuven, was it? Leuven. Yes, and actually one of our Ajahn, who's recently retired, he also graduated from the University of Leuven with a doctoral degree in law, I think it was. And Francis has also had taken courses in Harvard University. And he was just telling me about that, and I'm sure he'll share some of those experiences with you. He's got numerous educational qualifications, mainly master's degrees, okay? So you can learn a lot from him, but he was just sharing some wisdom with me that because he's a clever guy, he could always swat for exams at the last minute. But what I tell my students is, no, don't do that. Like, learn as you go and revise so that you don't put yourself under any undue stress. But anyway, we each have a different way of operating. And without further ado, I'm going to hand you over to Francis, okay? So I hope you'll really enjoy his presentation this morning. Thank you, Francis. Okay.
Hello. Good morning. First of all, I don't like when you're moving so far away from me, so I will be close to you all the time. What is your name again? I'm sorry? John introduced me. My name is Francis. I'm Belgian. I have one question for you before I start. Huh? So, who is happy? Who is happy? Are you happy? If you are happy, raise your hands. We have one happy person, two happy, three people. Okay, so in this room there is unhappy people. If you are unhappy, I think the first thing you should do is leave the room and come back when you are happy. I have decided to be happy because happiness makes me more successful. Happiness is what you need to drive yourself to be successful. If you want money, you can never have money when you're not happy. Okay? Imagine you make money and you are not happy. You have a boring life. Eh? So in my opinion, whatever you do, try to be happy. Today I'm not in a very good mood because I'm a little sick. So you don't get the best of me, and that's a pity because I'm really good. Eh? I think I'm one of the most interesting people you will ever meet in your life. And I'm very modest. I'm always very modest. Because we are Belgians, we are very modest. Today I will share with you the story of the company where I'm working now. The company is called Padang, PDI. The logo you see with the blue and the green is a logo, in fact, I developed in my office when I came to this company 6 years ago. Because the old logo was a little bit old-fashioned, it was not reflecting dynamism, it was not reflecting, sustainability. And my communication manager is with me and she can testify that. So I started playing with colors in my office and we came up with a new logo. And why is that important? Well, it's important because if you want to make change, you have to create a vision and you have to have a gestalt. You have to show something that people can look at. And so my people, Supichnan She walked on the road into shopping malls and she showed the old logo and the new logo to people in the street and she asked, what do you think about our logo, correct? And that's how our new logo was born and we changed the name from Padang Industry into PDI. So PDI is the story of an extreme makeover. Extreme means that, for instance, I started with 1,000 people, today I have less than 100 people. We started with a zinc mine and today we are in renewable energy. So we started only in Thailand and today we are a little bit spread over Asia. I always say we have changed the company from a monochromatic company into a what I call polychromatic company. So from a very single-minded company into a very open-minded company. And so I would like to share something very personal with you because I'm very proud. So before I explain you about extreme makeover of my company, I will share you my personal extreme makeover. Where is it? No, I mean the push forward. Okay, so this is me. This is me when I started in the company in 2012, and this is me today. So in 6 years working with this company, I lost 14 kilos. I became younger instead of older. I turned 60 this year. But I feel more dynamic than ever before. So I decided to offer myself a new body for my 60th birthday, and that's why it happened. Same time I decided to change the company in the same period. So the analogy is that if you want something, you can do it. So the power of the mind is more important than anything else, but again, if you want to be successful in whatever you do, please choose to be happy. Do not allow any unhappy feelings to come into your mind. Once, like 10, 15 years ago, I was in the United States and I met a very interesting person. His name was John Anderson. I don't know if you ever heard about John Anderson, but he is the personal coach of the Olympic team of America. And so when an athlete has to perform in sports, it's not only about his physical power, because you can train your physical power, but it's also about your mindset. So this guy, his only mission was to take away all the negative feelings out of the head of the athletes before they would start any new attempt to break a record at the Olympic Games. And what he said, I never forgot what he said. He said to me, to all the people in the audience, he said, positive people have more success than negative people. It's proven. If you think positive, you have more success. And what is the good news? The good news is that everybody can teach themselves to be positive. So that's the message I want to start off my presentation with. And let's now dig into my company. So I just added one slide about change management for you to understand. I guess you have all studied change management. You are all, I guess, MBA students, so you should be more intelligent than average people, I guess. I guess you did some research on the internet. And so I will just quickly share with you my vision about change. First of all, you have to recognize that change is needed. In my company, the company was a mining company in zinc metal with a mine in the northwest of Thailand, close to Myanmar. And 6 years ago, the chairman of the company, Tan Asa Sarasin, who is a very famous person in Thailand, he was personal principal secretary to King Bhumibol for 12 years. He was minister of foreign affairs. His father was prime minister of Thailand. There is even a road called after the Sarasin family. There is even a bridge to Phuket called the Sarrazin Bridge. So this person, he called me and he said to me, well, we need somebody to save the company because the company might be in trouble. So from 2012 to 2013, I looked into the company, and in 2013, I gathered some people around me that I could trust, and I told them, I have a mission impossible. My mission to save the company is a mission impossible, because simply the business model cannot work. If we want our company to survive, we need to decide for an extreme makeover. So I decided that there is a need for change. And then the worst thing I could, the most difficult thing started. I had to talk and convince all the stakeholders in my company. I had to convince the chairman of the board. I had to convince the board. I had to convince the shareholders. I had to convince the executive team. I had to convince my people, 1,000 people, that there is a need for change. I had people in the rooms like you, and I had to tell to these people, probably most of you will no longer work here in some years from now. Because if we want to save the company, many of you will have to leave, and we will have to help you find other jobs, because the Zinc model does not work anymore. So I built it consensus at different levels in the organization, top-down, starting with the board. And from that moment on, 2013, we could prepare the journey for change. Secondly, if you want to change, you need to lead. A company without a leader is not a company. Eh? Leadership is more important than management. At all your training, you will learn a lot of management techniques. Eh? Like how to read a financial statement, how to make a marketing plan, how to make a business plan. Great, but bullshit if you are not a leader. Nothing works if you are not a leader. Good news is everybody can be a leader. Eh? There is two types of leaders. You have leaders that are born leaders. They are what we call charismatic leaders. They are born with charisma, and everybody will lead them wherever you go. And then you have the inspirational leaders, that is people that are inspired, learn from other leaders and become leaders. My only advice to you is be your own leader, never copy another leader. You cannot, you must be your own leader. But as a leader, you have to lead your organization through change. And people have to believe in you, you have to be, let's say, straightforward, you have to be honest. You can sometimes show that you have doubts, and you can sometimes show emotions. I think I'm a very unusual CEO, no? Supichnan, she works with me 6 years. I show emotions to my people. I have cried with my own people. So it's okay. As long as you show determination and as long as people believe in you as a leader, you will be able to lead them into change and involve all your people, communicate a lot with your people. I travel to the sites myself and I explain all the time to my people what is happening. I remember once, like 3-4 years ago, I traveled to the mine site and I said that we would close the mine. 5 minutes later, there was already messages on Facebook and there was already some bad words against me on Facebook. So I said, okay, I will go back and I will explain it again to the people what I exactly mean and why there is a need for change. So communication, stakeholder engagement, I already talked about it. You have to coach and train people. We have invested a lot in coaching and training during the makeover. We have trained our people in change management, starting with the top. We have trained our people in project management, because we are to work a lot with projects. We have trained them in business excellence, so in how doing anything you do in an excellent way. Everything you do, you should do in an excellent way, because you have no, we cannot afford to lose money in unorganized activities. You allocate resources. And when you speak about stakeholder engagement, you should not forget your customers and you should not forget the society. So we had meetings with our own customers because we had to tell them that we would stop the business and that most probably they had to work with somebody else. I will tell you later what happened during those stakeholders meetings and how it even helped us to adjust the plan, the makeover plan. And then finally, sustainability. For me, sustainability is everything. When I was asked to join Padang, the first questions I had were about how sustainable is Padang as a company. I do not want to work for a company which is not sustainable. And sustainability is something you can do in your business, but it's also the way you do business. In my opinion, if you produce chemicals that are bad for the environment, you are not sustainable. But in my opinion, even if you produce chemicals that are good for the environment, but you do it in an unsustainable way, you are also not sustainable. I will talk with you about sustainability later in my presentation. So that's change management. It starts with a vision, a leader that leads the organization, asks stakeholders to be engaged and sustain the change. And so our journey started 6 years ago. What is Padang? Just quickly, Padang is a company. Today we are in the industry group of resources and we are changing the business type from mining and minerals or mining and metals into energy, because most of our revenue this year will be from renewable energy. We have a small registered capital, only 2.26 billion, so we are, in my opinion, a very small company. We have our share price today, it's 28.5. When I started in the company, it was 9. So during my 6 years in the company, the share price tripled. I think that's a very great achievement as well. So we have a market capitalization around 6 billion now. Shareholders, we are a publicly listed company, so you can all become a shareholder in my company. I am not, because I do not want to have any conflict of interest. I know all the time what is going on, and any time I would buy or sell shares, people might think that I am acting with insider information, so I don't. I own shares in the companies where I used to work, but not in the company where I work. The major shareholder is 25%, is the country group holding. It's very important in your company to have a stable shareholdership. If not, you must have a very strong board that can manage the company, but with a strong major shareholder, you can be very successful in achieving your goals. In the midst of the makeover of our company in 2015, our major shareholder decided to leave because it was a Dubaiese investment fund. They needed money to repay their debts. And they said, well, we want to sell our shares, which was a big problem for us because you are in an extreme makeover. You do not know even where you are going. You are not sure about your results. And then your major shareholder say, okay, I need to sell my shares. So we started to look for another shareholder and we found the country group and they agreed to become our major shareholder. The second shareholder is the Ministry of Finance since the beginning, and then we have some like the Thai NVDRs. It's like 4 overseas shareholders that have no voting rights, and then we have the Bangkok Bank. So a quite stable shareholdership at this moment, which is helpful in times of change. I have a lot of pictures, so I do not want to bore you too much. Didn't we have music? Oh, it's okay. It's okay. I wanted music. I wanted to play Jimi Hendrix today, but do you know Jimi Hendrix? Does anybody know Jimi Hendrix? You do, John. You do? A bit. So you must be the older student then. Okay, anyway. So the PDI history. So we started in 1981. There was this famous Thai person. His name is Khun Aswin Kongosiri. He is in the Bank of Thailand. And one of his he worked for the Minister of Finance, and somebody came to him with a mineral, with zinc, from the Maasdijk mine, and he decided, let's start this mine. He traveled all around the world, and he found a Belgian company called Vieille Montagne to be able to build this process, smelting process, in Taak. So this is the mining operations. The mine is like 3,000 rai area, huge area. We have decided to turn back the mine to nature better than we received it from nature. That is the idea. The concept is when you take something from nature and you want to give it back, it should be better than when you took it. So we have the greenest mine in the world now. We have been awarded by that, by several national and international awards. And so a year or three, four ago, I hired a biodiversity engineer from Belgium to help us to look into biodiversity and to recreate nature in the mine. So it doesn't look like that anymore. Today it is green. It will be handed back to the Royal Forestry Department by the end of this year. Most of the houses and the major president mansion is given to Princess Siritron. And so we are building a pagoda, because there used to be a pagoda, and now after the mine is finished, we want to build again the pagoda, a new one. And we also are building a museum, a mining museum. There will be a golden valley in the mine area, and there will be a lot of tourism, nature tourism in the mine. So you can see, this is now the mine, it's very green area. So this it will be closed, these are the ponds with the tailings, they will all be closed. Here will be the yellow, the golden park, let's say. The pagoda will be there. This used to be the last part of the mine pit. All the buildings have been removed, and there is everywhere green now. So whenever you use nature, you must always have respect and give it back to the country better than it was. So you see green mining, that's even here it's written, green mining. My dream was to build a hotel on top of the mountain. But very difficult, because not really very profitable hotel business in Maasdijk. So this is the zinc operations in Taak. So when the mine was opened, we needed to have a refinery. And for a zinc refinery, you need a lot of electricity, which was not available in Maasdijk. So we had to move over the mountains into Taak, and there the refinery was built. It is one of the top technologies in the world. There is only three or four plants like this in the world. And it's a pity that we have to close it, because it's a technology that has been very successful for this type of business. This is our products. So zinc metal. I guess you all know zinc metal. Zinc, when you fly into Suvarnabhumi, what do you see? You see zinc. Because the whole building is covered with zinc to protect it from corrosion. If you would not have zinc, everything would corrode very fast. So your car has been galvanized. In your car you have components made from zinc aluminium. The star on a Mercedes-Benz is made from zinc alloy. So you see, that's what we said we help to develop our country, the electricity poles, the airport, the galvanization of cars. So without zinc, that would be a big problem. And then the die casts, that's all the small appliances, small, even the matchbox, matchbox cars, Mattel, they are using zinc from Padang used to use zinc from Padang for their toys. We also are very active in supporting the development of the society. So when you operate in a sustainable way, you have to support the local societies. And supporting does not mean just giving money. Supporting also means, like what we do, is we give scholarships to students. We help the local schools. This is Koen Assas Sarrazin, the chairman of the company I was talking about. We have had numerous recognitions, so we have been awarded by the SET as the most innovative growing company, as the rising star company. So we have had, during the sustainability journey, we have been awarded many times, which is very, of course, encouraging for us. Here you can see Princess Cyritron handing over the Vetiver Award for Green Mining to our mine engineer. If you want to be successful, you have to celebrate success. So whenever you have a success, celebrate it, because it will generate more success. Try to be happy with every success you make and you will be more successful. So this story came to an end. The end started in 2016 with the closing of the mine. Also the closing of a roaster. We had a plant in Rayong where we import materials from all over the world to be treated in our plant. And then we have our smelter in Take where we produce the zinc. We had close to 1,000 employees in 2012. And by the end of this year, we will have 72. So that's the negative impact of the change, is a huge reduction in people. But we are creating new activities and we are re-employing people in new activities. Also, for all the people that left, we had the legal severance payment, we had also a separation premium, but we also organized a lot of occupational training so that the people were ready for any other job. There is nobody of our people unemployed. Everybody has a new job in other companies and we have helped them even to develop their competences to work in the new jobs. So, as I said in the beginning of my presentation, when you want to change, you need to have a vision. The vision of our company used to be the leading producer of high quality zinc in Southeast Asia. That was the mission. The vision is how you accomplish your mission. Our vision has always been that we will be driven by innovation and that we will balance concerns amongst the four major stakeholders in the company. So the clients, we will add value to our clients, we will respect our people, ecosystems and environment, we will support the communities in which we operate, and we will give the best possible return to a shareholder. So when you make your vision statement, you should always have your mission. What do you want to reach? Which type of leadership do you aim? And how do you want to do that? That's your vision. It's simple, but it should be shared and accepted by everyone. So we changed the mission statement from zinc into to be a leader in developing, driving and growing sustainable businesses in Southeast Asia. Until last year, it said in energy, materials and recycling, ecosystems. We decided to leave those words out because at the moment we are even considering other types of industry or businesses to invest when we believe we can add value to that with the competences we have. So, but this is the vision we share with our people, and in fact everybody should know it by heart. My executives, if they cannot, let's say, proclaim the mission or the vision, then they have a big problem. Huh? So my new assistant, I will have to tell her to ask you this next month. Huh? You have to know by heart. Huh? Well, she's my new assistant. Huh? My old assistant, she left me, but I have now somebody else. Okay. In my opinion, as I said to you before, if you do anything, you have to do it in a sustainable way. Also, a school or university should operate in a sustainable way, meaning a university should balance its goals and its achievements and its results over the major stakeholders of a school. And one of the major stakeholders of a school, of course, are the students, but it's also the professors of the school, it's also the people working in the school, it's also the authorities or whomever paying money to make the school work. We use the Brundtland Commission definition. So Brundtland Commission was a commission of the United Nations in 1987, and they defined sustainability. Sustainability does not mean only take care of environment does not mean only take care of people and does not mean only take care of economy. Sustainability means that you have to take care of the three of those. So sustainability is in the center of the model where social, environmental and economical goals meet. If you do something environmentally good and socially good, but it's not economical, it will not sustain. Because nothing sustains when it doesn't make money. And if you do something which is profit-making and which is good for the people because it employs people, but it kills the environment, it will not sustain. And if you do something which is any other combination of the two is not working. You need all the three of them to make your business sustainable. And so for us, we have defined CSR already 6-7 years ago. We said our sustainability is driven by innovation. When I want to invest something new in Thailand, I do not want to copy paste. Thailand is too good to copy paste. When we bring something to Thailand, it should be innovative. It should be a game changer. And I will tell you about the game changing technology that we will introduce into Thailand. We should work closely together with all stakeholders. When you define the future of your company, talk with your stakeholders like we did, for instance, with our customers. Take care of your people. Okay, I know it's a statement like everybody make, people are the most valuable assets, but without people there is no company. Eh? Most of the problems I had in making progress in my company was because of people. But most of the progress we made was also because of people. You cannot imagine how much resistance to change is in a company. There is huge resistance to change. And the higher in the company, the higher the resistance. Because people at an executive level, they have organized for themselves a very strong level of comfort. You know, they sit in their office, a big office, the bigger the better, of course. And they have a parking lot with their name. Because when you arrive in the morning in the parking and your name is above your car, it's better than an orgasm. Eh? It's the best thing you can have. Eh? Your own name to park your car, you know, big office, a long way for people to get in. And you can even, well, people don't even know that you're working. These people are the worst people against change. You have to remove them from your organization. And it's not typically Thai. It's everywhere in the world. Because I used to work in Belgium. In Belgium, the executive team, if you wanted to meet them, there was a doorbell at their office. You know, you had to ring. Ring, and then they would push a button, green or red. Green, you could come in, red, you couldn't. One night, I decided to go to the office after work with the technician, and we removed all the doorbells of all the executives. So, because I thought it was very stupid. As an executive, to create a distance between yourself and your people is the worst thing you can do. Because your people, they feed you, you know. Every morning, people come to you and give you feedback. And I always say, feedback is a breakfast for a champion. If you do not eat feedback, you will never be a champion. So, what I wanted to say is, people drive change, so make sure that you take care of people and respect people. Of course, we also want partners to act in accordance with social responsibility. So we do not buy materials from suppliers that are not social responsible. And when we measure the overall company performance, we do not only look at the results, but we also look at our CSR goals as a criterion to evaluate the company. So the change came and we decided to reorganize the company. So when you want to create a new company, when you want to change, you have to create a new organization. So what did we do? We decided about three main businesses, energy, materials and eco, and we reorganized the company. So we have now the biggest business unit at this moment is PDI Energy, because we have been most successful with renewable energy, but the one with the most, expected return will be materials business, because there we are really changing the game. So PDI Energy, at the moment, Energy is a business unit where we have a modest 50 megawatt of solar power, 37 megawatt in Thailand and 13 megawatt in Japan. So we started our first solar farm 2 years ago in Japan, from scratch. So we built a new farm in a country where we have never been. Solar energy is simple. Eh? There is nothing as easy. If you want to do something new in renewable energy, you just build a solar plant, eh? Because you can buy it almost turnkey. You build it, you plug it in, and it works. So that's what we did. But of course, you have to learn how to work in another country. Because, as I said, we were a very monochromatic company. We were only active in Thailand. Our supply was Thai, our customers were Thai, our people were Thai, everything was Thai. So very boring and monochromatic. So now, for the first time, we went to another country, Japan, where we had to invest. Now, in the meantime, we have decided on a new target, 150 megawatt by the end of this year, which means we need to build another 100 megawatt of renewable energy. We have an investment target of 5 billion. We own today, as I said, 50 megawatt operating farms, and we are developing projects in Japan up to 30 megawatts at the moment. We have also some residue ponds intact, so which means that it's like old, unused, well, it was where we used to landfill waste from the operations, which I never liked, but okay, it was there, so I couldn't change it. So I have decided to build solar farms on top of those residue ponds. And then we also signed a strategic partnership with a company called Canadian Solar. And this company is the biggest producer of solar panels in Thailand. They import the substrates from China because most of solar, let's say, substrates are produced in China, 90 to 95%. So in Canadian Solar decided to invest in Thailand, and we signed an agreement with them for 200 megawatt solar investments. So just quickly, this is an overview of our Thai solar projects. I'm not going to go into detail because it's not important, but just to let you know that we used to be in Thak province only. Now we have a farm in Meramat, in Khong Kaen, in Prachinburi, and in Samut Sakhon. Also, that changes, you know. People have to be able to work from the Bangkok office and manage small operations spread all over the country. And people also have to be able to manage, well, this was our first solar farm in Meramat. This is our beautiful our solar farm in, this is in Khong Kaen, I think, no? And so people also have now to manage the solar farms in Japan. But these days it's easy. Eh? You have remote access, so on your mobile phone you can check your performance. So every hour we can see how much money we make. And so solar farm is now generating a steady income with a very acceptable profit to the company. Debt to equity ratios. In Japan we work with 80% debt. Because the money is very cheap in Japan, so you do not invest much of your own. In Thailand, money is more expensive, so there we invest 50% equity most of the time. Now, you could... this is the first solar farm we ever built, yes. And this is the last one, we just commissioned 1st of March in Nogata, is in Fukuoka. Now, before I go to materials, you could wonder, why renewable energy? Why do you make over in renewable energy? So the makeover was decided based on the competences of our people. So I looked around in the company, and what did I see? We have a lot of engineers, you know, electrical engineers, mechanical engineers, chemical engineers. So I said, let's use these competences for the new business. I'm a chemical engineer myself. It's a long time ago. In fact, I'm a specialist in precious metals. So if you have any question about gold or silver or platinum or palladium, that's my cup of tea. I used to produce 40 tons of gold yearly and 1,500 tons of silver. So I'm a specialist in precious metals. Now coming back to our company, we looked at the competence and we said, well, these people will be able to do energy, they will be able to do materials, and they will be able to do recycling. That's how we came to the definition of the new competences. And in energy, the first idea was to do biomass. Because I said there is abundance of biomass in Thailand, so let's just collect all this waste from agriculture and let's in a sustainable way treat the waste and produce energy. Now, the main problem in Thailand is you cannot get access to the supply in a sustainable way. 70% of all biomass plants in Thailand fail. So that's why we decided not to do it at the moment. We also looked in waste to energy. But waste in Thailand is still a big mafia business. Sorry to say that, maybe I will be killed now. But it's true, if you want to get access to waste, you need to have access to certain people and you need to do certain things which we do not like to do. So we couldn't do waste, we couldn't do municipal waste, we couldn't do even industrial waste in the east of Thailand because there is other companies already let's say moving in that business. So waste energy didn't work. Then we wanted to do wind energy. Now what is the problem of Thailand? There is no wind. Eh? In this country there is only wind in Korat and a little bit in the south. That's it. So if you want to build a wind farm, you can't. Hydropower, it would be fantastic, but people are against hydropower in Thailand because you have to relocate people, you have to change land into hydropower dams, and people don't want that. So there is all these ideas we had, we could not realize. And then we wanted to do, of course, solar, and hence we wanted to build a solar farm on wasted land. But for solar, you need to get your PPAs, your power purchase agreements, which is also not easy in Thailand. So, in summary, for renewable energy, for us to invest in Thailand was not easy. And so, at the moment, we are only focusing at solar. It's a pity because Thailand has a big energy problem. In some years from now, there will not be enough energy. I warn you already. So what do we do now in Thailand? We use gas. We use coke and we use petrol. Eh? So we continue to produce CO2 and we continue to kill the world for our children. Eh? By the way, we don't own the world. Eh? We are borrowing it from our children. So if your grandchildren want to have a good world to live in, you better fucking stop producing CO2 eh? Because it's too late at the moment already. Eh? So that's why I am so much in favor of renewable energy, and this country really should focus on renewable energy. So we continue with solar. Now, having this said, the second business we want to invest in is materials. And so the first one is PDI Metals, and it's a very interesting example because I told you, we talked with our stakeholders, with our customers, and we told them that we wanted to stop the zinc business. And then they said, well, you know, Padang has always been such a great supplier to us, and we do not want to lose Padang, and we do not want to lose the service, the technical service of Padang. So I promised the customers in a big meeting room, like hundreds of customers were present, and I promised them, okay, we will look into that, and we, if we can find a way to trade zinc for you, we will buy and sell in the Thai market, which we did. And so we created a new business unit called PDI Metals. And so PDI Metals, you see, I am on this picture. I'm like the new Steve Hobbs, of Steve Jobs. You see? Oi. Oh, where is my, you see? Well, I lost myself, you see? See? This is before my makeover. I was still, this is 14 kilos away. So we had only 10 or 11 people. We have a business model where we use the metal of the supplier to sell it to our customer, and they finance the pipeline. So we do not finance anything. And we hedge the metals. So if the prices go up or down, we have no effect. So that's what we created. But the business will create a huge revenue in 2018 already, same as last year. But of course, at lower margins than we are used to in the metals business. So we will supply more than 50,000 tons to the market. We have introduced Line as a communication tool with our people. By the way, we also have a Line chatbox in the company. So like 5 years ago, I opened a Line chatbox and the idea was talk to your managing director. So all the people can communicate directly with me on a Line chatbox, which is sometimes very funny, no? But it's good to have a direct line with your people. So PDI Metals was born out of this stakeholder discussion we had with the customers. And okay, it will generate like 30, 40 million profit every year. It's not much, but at least it's enough to pay my salary. Huh? It's a joke. Huh? Okay, so then we have the most important one in PDI Materials is PDI CRT. PDI CRT is a joint venture between our company and a Norwegian innovative company, and we will bring a technology to Thailand which does not exist in Thailand and which does not exist in the whole of Asia. It's called a submerged plasma. If you will search the internet, you will find plasma gasification, which is something completely different. This submerged plasma is a technology that I developed in my previous company together with the Swedish company, and we are now Padang, the first company in the whole of Asia to use the technology. The advantage of that technology is that you can treat any type of hazardous waste, and you can turn it into a valuable material. So we will start to use it for the waste of the steel industry. Today in Thailand, the steel industry produces a lot of waste which can't be processed. So it's landfilled, or it's illegally landfilled, or it's exported, or it's illegally exported, but there is no sustainable solution. So with our investment, we will have a sustainable solution, and we will produce zinc oxide from the steel waste. And zinc oxide, you need as a vulcanization aid for rubber. And the rubber industry in Thailand is a very important industry. So what we will do is we will use waste from Thailand to produce a material that can be used in rubber, which is one of the most important products in Thailand. But the same technology will be used to recycle electronic waste, for instance. I don't know if you realize, but in your phone there is a lot of gold. Eh? Every mobile phone, I know that you love phones, young people like phones. Eh? I do also like phones. And I think every 6 months you have a new phone? No? How many times do you buy a new phone? Oh, yeah, okay, okay. Which means that every year, and what do you do with your old phone? You keep it, voilà. Most of the people keep their old phones in a drawer. When you have 1,000 kilo of this, you have 350 grams of gold. I don't know if you realize that. So if you could, you could start a collection action at the Assumption University, and you ask everyone to bring their old mobile phones. When you have 1,000, one phone is like 200 grams, I think, 150 grams. So when you collect enough phones, you can have enough gold, but also silver and palladium and copper, and then you can sell it, we can treat it for you, and we can even pay. You can make good money from that if you want. So electronic scrap, that was also one of the goals in the future. But also we are already preparing this project to treat batteries from hybrid and electric cars, because electric cars will use a lot of batteries, and their batteries needs to be recycled. Today there is no good recycling process in the world existing for lithium-ion batteries. So we will be able to do that in our furnace. Also, solar farms. When you build a solar plant, what will you do with the panels in 20 years from now? It needs to be recycled. So we can also use that submerged plasma for the recycling. So that's why I'm saying in our product portfolio or process portfolio, this type of business will help to generate high returns, and it will last for long. When we speak about returns, because I guess you like to know something about finance, our goal is to have a return on equity average 10 to 12%. So if the shareholder puts an equity of 100, the goal is to have 10 to 12 return on equity every year. A solar farm has around 10%. A project like this, we have returns around 25%. Can you imagine? So you put 1,000 in the company and you have every year you get 250 back. So that's a huge return. We have the sole rights on this technology, and when we will start building it, we will acquire the rights for the whole of Asia. So if anybody in Asia wants to copy, they have to pay us. That's the idea behind it. So that's the process. I don't know if there is there engineers in this room? Anybody an engineer? Yeah, but okay. And no students engineers? Oh my God. No engineers. Without engineers, the world will die. Eh? If you only have MBAs, what you're gonna manage? Jesus. Anyway, good. I don't want to insult you. Eh? But anyway, this is very interesting because in the middle of this flow sheet, you see this furnace. It operates in a plasma state. I don't know if you know anything about plasma. In fact, you know a solid, you know a liquid, and you know a gas. But there is the fourth aggregation level, which is what we call plasma. And in a plasma, the molecules are so excited that they are bumping into each other all the time, even more than in a gas, which means in the plasma, temperatures can go up to 10,000 degrees. So here in the top of the plasma torch, you can have 10,000 degrees. It's unbelievable. So this is and with this technology, you can separate molecules, you know. In the technology, it can separate zinc from lead and gold and anything else, because it is a molecular separation technology at a very high temperature. And that's non-existing, as I said, in Asia. There is only 4 or 5 furnaces operating in Europe. So this is the technology of the future. And that's why we are investing in it. Now, most probably for us to be successful in that, we will need more technology. I told you, that's why I was asking, is there engineers in this room? So we are now looking into a joint venture with another big Thai company to have more technology experience to make it successful. Then the third business and the last one we are talking about today is eco-management. So we have a lot of experience in managing waste and turning waste into valuables. So we have decided to build a waste management center in the north of Thailand, in Thak, together with a Japanese company called Doha. And so we are now preparing that project. The biggest problem is resistance from the people. You know, communities are always opposed against everything. Eh? People like comfort, but they do not want to pay for anything to have discomfort. Eh? People want to use electricity as much as they can, but they do not want nuclear power. Or they do not want a hydro dam. They want nothing. But how on earth can you live and use energy if you do not invest in the creation of energy? People, they want to use consumables and produce waste, but they don't give a shit about who handles the waste, as long as it's not next to their door. You know how many waste we produce in Thailand every day? Have you any idea? In Bangkok, we produce 2 kilos of waste every day per person. Imagine 10 to 12 million people. It's 12 million, it's 24 million kilos of waste. 24,000 tons of waste every day. When one truck is 20 tons, you can count by yourself. Huh? It's like more than 1,000 truckloads of waste produced every day in Thailand. Can you imagine? And you don't know what happens to that waste? All the shit that we all produce? It's mostly landfilled. So Thailand is becoming one big landfill of waste. And that's what we didn't want. We want to treat that waste. In Europe, for instance, we produce like 400 grams of waste per person per day. So it's 1/5 and it's still going down. So that's the major problem of countries like Thailand. We produce too much waste. When I go to the Big C or to the another shop, you know what I do before I leave the shop? I remove all the waste, all the packaging from what I buy. And I say to the shop owner, please take care of your own shit. I don't want to treat your waste. I don't need all this waste. So leave all the waste where you buy it and make them take care of your waste. That's the only way you can change the world. So anyway, with PDI Eco, we will treat those wastes. We will try to turn it into something valuable like energy. Inevitably, there will be some landfilling, which is very pity, but then it's better that we do it in a controlled way than in an uncontrolled way. So what I tried to tell you up to now, and how much time do I have left? Oh, okay. Am I boring you? Am I boring you? Are you okay? Where are you from? China.
Yeah.
Okay, and you? Nepal, and you? Also Nepal, wow. Okay, and where are you from? Myanmar, and you? Also? So it's like the whole world. Is there anybody from Europe here? Where are you from? Denmark. Oh, guten Tag. I don't speak Danish. Eh? I'm not German. No, eh? I'm Belgian. Eh? Aber ich spreche ja Deutsch. Eh? Wenn Sie das wünschen, das macht kein Problem. Ich kann ja auch auf Deutsch reden. Oh, io parlo italiano, eh? Quando voglio. Eh? Non è problema. Eh? No, I'm Belgian, so. And I have a French accent, you know. That's one of my handicaps. Eh? Now I lost my lead. Eh? You make me lost what I was saying. Eh? You distract me. Eh? So the point is that what I wanted to tell you is that we have changed our company. We stopped being a zinc company in mining and metals, a very, let's say, conservative, monochromatic company. And we changed into something new, polychromatic, with a totally different focus. At the moment, it's energy. It is materials and it's eco. But if any new idea comes to our mind, which we believe we can invest, we will. So last week only, there was a person who proposed to me to start a new project together with the university to treat napier grass. I don't know if you know napier. Napier is a kind of grass that grows very fast. You can harvest 3 times per year. You can put it into a digester, you can make biogas, and from the biogas you can make electricity. So that's a new idea which we are pursuing since last week. So before I close the presentation, I would like to speak a little bit about performance and outlook, because it's nice to tell you a story. You can say, oh, Francis, he's a nice talker, huh? He gives us a nice story, but in the end, what did he accomplish? So how do I measure that I have been successful up to now? Well, it's very easy. Eh? We measure it by the performance of the company. And so this year, 2017, we had the best result in the company in the last 10 years. We had the third best result in the whole history of the company. And this happened in a year of a makeover. Eh? So in this year, we had to let people go. We had to pay for the people to go. We had to manage down the operations. We had to clean the operations. We had to manage the customer expectations. We had to manage shareholder expectations. And in this year, we have been able to produce the best result in the last 10 years. I think I should get some kind of a Nobel Prize for that. Well, it's a little bit exaggerated. It's not only me, by the way, Glenn. Huh? Of course, I'm the leader, but I'm nothing without my people. But you have to know, I started the company and I had 14 executives. 10-4. 14 executives, people I had to pay a lot of money to sit in a sofa and to watch other people working. You know, the amount of managers in an organization tells you something about how badly you are organized. The more managers you have, the worse you are organized. Because what does a manager do? He manages other people. If people manage themselves, you need less managers. So the more managers you have, the worse you are organized. The more executives you have, the worse you are organized. Today we have 5 executives. So we reduced the number of executives to 5 people only, including myself. That's what we did all in the year 2017, and we produced almost double of the profit of the year before. So our profit was almost 1 billion. My goal was 1 billion. It would be a magical number, but we couldn't reach it. Last minute, we only had 905. Revenues went up with 20%. Dividend only goes up 50% because I do not want to give all the money I make to the shareholders. I want to use some of the money for the company and for my own people. So what we did is I used part of the money to pay my people to leave. If you are a sustainable company, you are not greedy. You do not take everything for yourself. It's okay to make money. There is nothing bad about making money. Eh? I like to make money and I like to be rich. Of course I do. But you have to share. So we shared with our people. Next slide. Okay. So some highlights of last year. What did we achieve? So we realized the strategic makeover plan. I can, in the SET Stock Exchange of Thailand, we are now quoted as a company that is a leading example in a makeover. I don't know if you know other examples, but for instance, when you look at Nokia, you know what Nokia first did in the beginning, you know? The first business of Nokia. Very first business of Nokia. Anybody knows? They make toilet paper and they make rubber boots. That was Nokia. And then they changed into mobile phones and now they changed into services. So that's extreme makeover. So that's what we do now. Also, of course, not that extreme, but in another way. We moved full scale ahead with the PDI metals business. We acquired operating solar farms. And honestly, that's one of my problems now, is to get these solar farms operated by our own people, because my people are not used to work on remote locations with remote access to remotely control solar farms with people that are delocated at those different sites. We are used to work in a big site with all the people around us and serving us all the time, you know, and that's what my people have to learn. That's the difficulty. We have finalized the construction of our solar farm in Nogata. We became certified as a member of the Private Sector for Collective Action Coalition Against Corruption. So I'm very hard on that. And honestly, corruption is still there. We are trying to do our project in Taak. And we have been asked by certain people to do certain things to get our permits, which I don't want to. So it might be that we cannot continue with our project in Taak for those reasons. We also achieved higher scores for corporate governance, and we have now attained a very good classification level. Good corporate levels for us is a very important way of doing our business. So the financial highlights, I already explained to you, but I think you should look at this one, since you are MBA students. A return on equity of 20% last year, I don't think it's bad. And also, if you look at the total assets we use, including the loans from the financial institutes, our return on assets is 14%. Often when you will analyze a financial statement, you will look to return on equity. I can advise you, if you really want to evaluate the quality of a company, also look on the return on the total assets. How is this company capable to use all the assets to generate a return? And often you will see return on assets below 10%. You will not often find a return on asset exceeding 10%. So I am very happy that this year we could do 14%. So this is the financial position of the company. Whenever you want to learn about the company, you have to look at three things. You look at the state income statement, you look at the statement of financial position, and you look at the cash statement. And those three pages tell you everything about the company. If you read it very carefully, what you can see here is that our company has a big problem. The big problem of our company is that we have not enough innovative ideas to invest our cash. Look at this company. We have debt to equity very low. We have a very low debt. And the total assets of the company are 7.4 billion and the equity is 5 billion. So which means we have only 2.5 billion debt. which means we do not have enough ideas to invest, and that's the problem of the company. We need more investments. Looking at the asset side, you can see we have 1.6 billion cash and growing. At the moment, we are exceeding 2 billion cash. So, and we need more ideas to invest. If you have an idea, just call me and maybe we can talk. But not small. I want at least half a billion investment and then we can talk about it. So, but in the last year, we have created, let's say, almost 2 billion extra asset value for the company. When you look at the book value for the shareholders, the book value has increased to 22. So we did not only perform very well, but we also created more cash and we created more potential value for any shareholder in the company. And then the next slide is also very interesting. This is the share price of the company. Okay, we took the share price always at the last trading date of the year, because you need to do something. So we said, okay, let's take the share price at the last trading date of the year. I started in 2012 around 9 baht. I don't know how much is the share price now. Did you check it? Check it. So at the moment, yesterday it was 28.5. So our share price tripled in 5 years. We had a dip here. And I know why, because I had to clean my books from assets which had no value, you know. There has been investments in the past 10 years. Ah, voilà, the share price continues to rise. We are at 28.75. So I cannot give you any advice on buying or selling. I can just say, if you love me, buy my shares. Just do it because you love me, for no other reason. Because I'm a very likable person. And then if the share price dropped, then you just think you made me happy. That's the only thing that's important. So anyway, I'm very proud with this result also. So it shows again that we have been successful in our makeover. How does the future look like? Well, in 2018, results will not be of the same level as last year, because now we are in the first year of the new Padang. So we cannot generate the same level of revenues. And revenues, yes, but not the same level of profit. But so we will further invest in renewable energy. We will take our decision on the materials business. And we will also optimize the management of all existing assets, because we have a lot of assets now which are no longer used. So most probably we will sell some of those assets to add to the profits this year. No, before we stop, because this is my last slide, Glenn. The next one. First of all, I would like to tell you something. If I have insulted anyone in the room, don't take it personal. If I have been different than you expected, yeah, I am who I am. So I am like, I feel that I'm not really the average type of CEO that you will meet. My boss in Belgium always told me you are a very, very Einzelganger. I don't know how to say it in English. You do your own thing all the time, but please never change. That's who I am. Now, I would like to share my personal ideas on change before we close this meeting. This is what I learned. Some of these things you have heard already, I think. There is nothing new, but this is what I feel. First of all, when you change, you have to create a vision. As a leader in change, you have to say, this is where I want to go. Create a vision, share the vision with everyone and preach it. It means, like a priest, repeat it and preach all the time about your vision. Until the people understand, and one day they will, not all. And I will tell you what you have to do with the people that don't follow you. Secondly, lead by example. Show the example. If you want your people to do things, do it by yourself. I give you one example, very simple. I have a clean desk policy. You can visit my desk anytime, my office, and you did, huh? On my desk, there is almost no papers. Why? Because the more papers on your desk, the more mind traffic. You will always be distracted by all the papers. So I manage my priorities and I put everything in drawers. And when I need, I make a plan of what I'm doing, and when I need to do something, I take it out of the drawers. Don't be tempted to read your mail all the time. The world can turn, the world will continue without you reading your mail for half a day. The world will not end when you don't read your mails for half a day. So lead by example. And when you lead by example, you can demand your people to do the same. And if you want to be efficient, you have to manage your priorities. Take decisions. Do not be afraid to take decisions. I love to take decisions. It's the thing I love the most. Even if it's not good, but take decisions. You should not be hesitating. Because when you hesitate, your people will hesitate and change will not happen. People don't like leaders that hesitate. When you look in the history, the most successful leaders, even the bad ones, are the ones who are really not hesitating. Move fast. Please don't be slow. If you are slow, you lose the game. Change must happen fast, and speed is an element of competition. If you want to be the better in the with your competitors, be faster than them. That's a big problem, in my opinion, in Thailand. The speed of change, in my opinion, is too slow. Ah yeah, and that's one I like. Be ready for blood, sweat and tears. What does it mean? It means it's a hard job. You will have to fight, you will lose blood, you will cry, and you will sweat a lot. Honestly, I did cry. I had tears in my eyes at certain moments in the past 5 years. Is that a bad thing? No, not at all. But be ready. Be ready to cope with emotions, emotions that go any direction, because you are doing something very deep. You are going into the genes of the company, so it's emotional. And then last one, be patient, of course. It's a little bit a paradox. I say be fast, but be patient. And that one I like. You have to promote early believers. If there is people with you that believe in change, promote them. Even if they are not the best, put the people inside of other people that believe in change. And the people that have a negative attitude, you should execute them. So if you have a negative attitude, I will have to kill you. And I will have to kill you while everybody can see it. Because I have to show that I do not accept negative attitude in my company. Of course, I don't kill people in these days. We used to do that in the medieval times. We don't do that anymore. But remove them. Remove them from your organization, because these people, they cause a lot of damage to your organization. So, in summary, this is what I would like to share with you today. I hope you have some questions. But I think I've been very clear. So, Glenn, I maybe hand it over to you now.
Thank you, my brother Francis. That was well done. Okay. Now, you remember what my brother Francis said? Be ready to kill. So I want you to ask questions. Let's go to Denmark first, come.
Okay. My name is Dennis Wagner. Dennis Wagner, is that German? Yeah, yes. Yeah, that's right. Well, my question is, since you're in the mineral business, if Donald Trump implement, you know, the traffic on steel, and aluminium, what will happen to the global business?
I didn't understand your question.
Oh, okay. There's been a lot of talk in the United States about, implement the traffic, tariffs on...
tariffs!
Yeah, tariffs. Ooh. On aluminium and steel, right?
Yes.
What will happen if they do that?
Okay, that's a political question. When an asshole becomes the boss of a country, anything can go wrong. I am European. You are a European. In Europe, we believe that working together amongst countries will improve trade. So if you start with tariffs or whatever, it will reduce trade. It's a very we first approach. I don't believe in a we first approach. I believe the only good approach is an approach where you work together. And Belgium, together with the Netherlands and Luxembourg, we were the founders of the European Union. Eh? So it was Benelux, and we grow it and grow it and grow it, and then, okay, we became a little bit victims of our own success, but the trade has been improved a lot in Europe. So I believe that imposing this type of tariffs, I cannot imagine how that can help a country at all. That's my personal opinion. I think it's a stupid decision, but okay, it's the same as the wall. Eh? Okay, you know we had a wall in Europe. Eh? I was in Berlin in 1989 when the wall was removed. So the freedom came to us. Why would you build a wall? I think this over-protectionism is not good in the world. I only hope that in Asia, ASEAN will also become a real unity with these 10 countries. I believe that Thailand can play a very dominant role in ASEAN because we are centrally located. And why is a union important? Because in a union, small countries also have a stake. You know, when you are a big company, a big country like America, yeah, you almost don't care about the others, eh? And you dictate your role everywhere in the world. When you are a small country, the only way to be someone is to make liaisons with other countries. Eh? So I believe very strongly in the union. I'm happy that the UK left the union, because UK is not Europe. Eh? I love them. Eh? But Denmark, for instance, is a very strong supporter of the union.
Because we're a small country.
You're also small. How many people? 3 million? 5 million. Minus one, because you are here.
Good. Okay, let's come to this side of the room.
Tell us your name. My name is Zhi. I come from China. I'd like to, what is your challenges about your company today? What do you think?
The challenges of my company?
Yes.
Ooh. First challenge is, I think the biggest challenge is to find enough projects to invest. You know, we have a lot of ideas. We have a lot of cash available. We have good people. But it's very difficult to find good projects. A project with a return, let's say 10-12%, because if we invest in a project with only 5-6%, it's not enough. The shareholder will expect more. Eh? So the number one challenge is to find good projects. Number two challenge is to retain my good people. Because now in the makeover, I had to let go a lot of people. And of course, we lost good people also. When you reduce from 1,000 to less than 100 people, there is also good people that go. And some of the good people that are still with us, they might be losing faith in the future of the company if we cannot bring enough new projects. And I give you one example. Last week, Friday, my hedging manager came to me and he resigned. And I said, well, okay, I understand you, and it's a pity. He's 45. He said, well, Francis, if I want to do something new, now is the moment. And I'm not sure that you will be reaching fast enough all the new projects. So yes, you will lose people. My personal assistant, she's now my new personal assistant. The previous one, she resigned in November, and she said, I resigned because maybe you will leave, and when you leave, I don't want to work here. So, which is not true, I will not leave. Eh? Glenn, I cannot leave. Eh? But the point is, second challenge is losing talent of people that you have. And the third challenge, in my opinion, and this is specifically in Thailand, is we have very complex rules and regulations to get a permit, you know. To build a solar farm, you need like 10 to 12 permits. It's so absurd, so stupid, that you need all these things just to do something good for the country. Like in Thak, we have already, the Department of Industry Works has selected the Thak site as a site for industrial waste management because it's a very good location. We have a good we are far from the close by villages. We have a good reputation and a good image, but still people oppose against it, and then the authorities have no guts to push it through. So rules and regulations prevent us in our country to make progress. It's good that you have rules and regulations to keep the crooks out, but rules and regulations should not be preventing good companies to grow. That's all that.
Great. Your name, country, and question.
Like, Zahir Hussain from Bangladesh. And like, I was just curious, as you mentioned, like, you wanted to get access to the waste of the country, right? For a better cause, but you couldn't because of the mafia and like other people. Like, but what's so big fuss about it? What do they do with the waste and all?
What do they do with the waste? Okay, you have three types of waste in Thailand. You have municipal waste, you have industrial hazardous waste, and you have industrial non-hazardous waste. And you have a fourth category, which is the biggest scum of all, is the medical waste. I don't know if you realize it, but our medical waste in Thailand, including pathological waste, is often landfilled with municipal waste or illegally exported to Cambodia. So the needles used on your body can be found in Cambodia in the nature. Is that what we want? Is that the image that Thailand wants as a medical hub, that all people from all over the world come to Thailand for being cured, and all the waste produced in the medical industry is landfilled in a very inconvenient way? The problem, we have a solution. The problem is that the public hospitals cannot afford to pay for it. It's the good solution to treat medical waste is more expensive than today. And we need like 3,000 baht per ton. And they can only afford like 600-700 baht per ton. So the private hospitals would like a solution like that because it will kill their image if nothing happens to medical waste. So what happens today to waste? Most of the waste is landfilled. Very simple. And sometimes landfills start to burn. As some years ago around Bangkok, there was landfills burning. The only way to stop that is to organize it differently. But then people will have to pay for it. Huh? In Europe, we pay 100 euros per ton as a producer of the waste, which means I pay 4,000 baht for 1 ton of waste to be treated. In Thailand, the communities pay 300 baht. Honestly, for 300 baht, you cannot recycle municipal waste in an environmentally friendly way. So the only way which can be changed is that authorities change the legislation. Now, then you have industrial waste, like I told you. There is also a lot of industrial waste, hazardous and non-hazardous. In Europe, we do not make a distinction. In Europe, for us, any waste is hazardous. We don't care. We will not consider certain waste from the industry less hazardous than other waste. So there we have dedicated equipment, and there the government in Thailand is taking initiatives. So you have some companies, but the ones who do it in the most correct way are not making profit. So again, we have to increase the income stream. If you want to do it in a sustainable way, you have to increase the income stream, because today there is industrial waste illegally landfilled. Eh? So when I say the mafia in control of that, please don't quote me, because maybe the mafia will come and kill me. But I think that there is still too much people involved in the waste business that are not really taking well care of it. And the only way we can change it is if the authorities have the laws in place and enforce the law. So we are now investing in this industrial waste management facility in the north of Thailand. But if the communities oppose against it, we will never be able to build it. Huh? So that's the paradox. Huh? The paradox between the needs for waste management and the people don't liking it to having it close to them. So we need a strong government. And if any government can do it, it's this government. Huh? They should enforce it, in my opinion.
I think I've got to turn focus to the ladies, you know, and let's go to Myanmar.
Hello, sir. I'm Niji. I'm from Myanmar. So my question is, why your company choose Japan instead of other countries in the Southeast Asia?
Okay. Thank you, Myanmar, for your question. Honestly, it's a little bit of a coincidence. It's a coincidence because we did meet people in our network, and these people were already operational or working with projects in Japan, and they proposed these projects to us. So, secondly, I do not want to add many countries at once into the business model. I believe that for us to be able to grow, we should grow country by country. So we are now looking in Laos, and when we did Japan, we did not want to do another country, because my people have to be able to install management in these countries, to work with these countries, to learn about the legislation, taxation issues. Now, Japan was a good start, first of all, because there is a good historical relation between Japan and Thailand. There is streets which allow us to invest, although we cannot own land. But like for taxation, there is bilateral agreements. And Japan is also a country where it's easier to invest, because when you go to Japan and you say, okay, I want to do this, and they approve it, you can do it. Huh? I'm sorry to say, but in certain countries, they promise you something and then you want to do it and then it doesn't work. Huh? Because they want something on the road. Eh? No, not in Japan. Also, the tariffs for solar energy are very high in Japan. Japan is in need of electricity since the... what's the name again? This power plant that... Fukushima. So since the nuclear power incident in Japan, they are closing down nuclear power plants, so they need renewable energy. So We have a power purchase agreement with a feed-in tariff of, is it an adder or a feed-in tariff in Japan? You remember? Of 32 yen, which is like 11 baht. In Thailand, we only have 5.6. So we get a very high return in Japan.
There's one more question from China. So I want to know that do you have any plan to open your companies or do any investment in China? Because almost every big company around the world, they also want to touch the Chinese market because it's really huge. And also, based on the Chinese government requirement, any foreigner company, if they want to invest in China, they must share their technology with government, with Chinese government. So will you accept that? Yeah, that's all.
Okay. In my previous company, which is called Yumicar, we already invested in China. I do believe that China has a very great potential for foreign investments. My concern was that when we invested in China, that the technology would become available to other companies and that we would lose the intellectual property of the technology. So it's a difficult question to answer. Yes, we would be interested to invest in China. The relation between China and Thailand is a very positive relation. And it's becoming better and better, I think. It's growing more positive. I think Thailand is growing closer to China these days. I am a little bit reluctant to bring a new technology to China, because I know the Chinese, they are so good in taking it, improving it, and copying it, and doubling it. So we must be careful. The point is also the chairman of my executive committee, he is, I think, a president or the chairman of the Thai-Chinese friendship community. So he has indeed asked us to look into China. So most probably, if ever I talk here again in 1 year, maybe I can give you some examples of our look into China, yes.
Thank you.
I'm Shail Pradhan from Nepal. My question would be, how big of a challenge was it for you to filter your resources from 1,000 to less than 100, and how did you do it? Thank you.
Okay. In my life, I have fired more people than I hired people. Is that good? I think most people will not like what I'm saying now. In 1995, in my Belgian company, I had to decide about a makeover. It's like 20 years ago. Huh? In those days, I was young and beautiful, handsome, 40 years old. Now I'm old, but still handsome. So I looked into our process, and we were treating concentrates. So we were importing concentrates from all over the world into Belgium to produce silver, gold, and stuff. And I said, well, we can't continue to do so because it's not sustainable. It's not sustainable to dig mines in other countries and to bring everything over the sea to Belgium and to treat it in Belgium. Mining concentrates should be treated close to the mine. So I introduced the concept in those days, what I call urban mining. I said, let's consider every city as a mine and let's do urban mining. Let's look around what we can find and treat it. And that's what we did. But the flip side of this was that I had to reduce people. So at those days, I had 1,800 people in my plant and I only needed 800. So I had to reduce also 1,000 people. So I talked with the CEO of my company. I was not the CEO, I was plant manager. Later that CEO became the chairman. Anyway, and I talked with him and I said, well, we have a big crisis. We need to change and we need to reduce people. What he said to me is something I will never forget. He said to me, always be honest. Be honest with people and explain. So explain to people why you have to do it. Because if we would not do the makeover, everybody would lose his job. We would have to close the plant and we would not even have money to clean it. So I said, no. So I organized during 3 weeks, I organized sessions with people as much as this group, day and night. And I went to the plant day and night and I explained to the people, this is what we have to do to the company, this is the need for change. And when you look at this table, probably two of you will have to leave. One can stay and two will have to leave. But I promise you, when you leave, I will take care of you. I will take care of you with money. I will take care of you with outplacement. And I can tell you, in Europe, it was much more difficult because we have big unions, you know. And my company was totally unionized. So I explained it to everyone. And we did the makeover with zero strike. We had 0 days of strike. And Belgium is quite socialist, so I have nothing against, so I prefer communists more than socialists, by the way. So we had 0 days of strike. So when I reflect back to Padang, in Padang it was a little easier because in Thailand there is no unemployment. In Belgium 10%. So in Thailand there is no unemployment. Also in Padang, I had a lot of people who were like 55 plus. So, and people are more easy to retire at an older age. Eh? But still, it remains difficult because you have to say to people they have to leave. And many of these people worked with the company for 30 years. And they were very unhappy and sad. Eh? But I talk with them, and I remember last time I was in Taak was in August last year, I don't remember. I go to Taak. When there's 500 people and I speak to the people and I gave them a present in person to all of them to leave. And they, you can imagine that Thai people, they came to me, they hugged me, they wanted a selfie with me. So it's all about opening your heart and being honest. Because you have to face the truth, eh? Even if it's ugly, eh? You have to face it and you have to do it. Eh? So that's, I think the way we did it was just paying respect to people and being always fair, honest, direct, not having a hidden agenda. And then in the end in Belgium, to go back to that company, we go down to 800. In the meantime, we rehired 600 people. Eh? So they're back to 1,400.
Hello, sir. My name is Aaron. I come from China. So your business is including the recycling and waste management and also nuclear energy. From your financial statement, it shows a good, very good performance, and you are also looking for a high return investment. You are looking to seek for a good project, right? And all of your business is green business, we can see. And will you still choose the same or similar industry to investment? And how will you manage your market risk by using your investment portfolio? That's my question. Will you still choose the same or similar business to invest?
Why?
Yeah, will you? Will you?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay, so I think I tried to answer this in my presentation. When we decided for the new business, I looked into the competences of the people of the company and the competences of the company. So I think in your MBA training, you have learned about core competences. You know the definition of a core competence? I can ask you, but I will not. A core competence is a set of, every company has a competence is something simple, but a core competence is a set of competences that when you combine them into a unique mix, you are different from the competition. So for instance, in my previous company, the core competences were flexibility, reliability, and complexity. So we were able to manage complexity in a flexible way and in a reliable way. And in doing so, we were better than the competition. So I defined these competences for my company, and based on these competences, we decided on energy, materials, and recycling. Also because we believed that there was a need in Thailand for that. In the meantime, the board changed. A new board member came in, new board members came in, and they said, well, don't focus on Thailand anymore. Go abroad. Look at other Asian countries. Now, I do not think for us it would be wise to start a hospital business. I mean, like a medical business or a bank, because that's not our cup of tea. So it should be something industrial, whatever we do. But I do not exclude anything else. I mean, manufacturing can be okay, and anything. So, but that's exactly the challenge. The problem is to find these targets, you know? It's not easy. It's not like buying a house. You cannot just walk on the street and run around until you find something to buy. You just can't. That's very difficult. So I cannot really answer your question directly. I can only tell you that we keep looking for industrial activities which in one way or another have some similarity with what we have done. And secondly, we want profit generating business. I mean, good revenues, acceptable at acceptable risks. But so I cannot give you a real fixed answer on what type of business we would like to invest on.
A very big thank you to my brother Francis. We are both brothers, you know that?
Yes. I'm the tallest in the house.
my brother Francis, you've honored us, not just with your presence, but with your intervention today. I think it's one of the best that we've received in the recent past. And I want to say a big thank you.
Welcome.
Right. But I also want to mention this. You are the second significant Belgian to have spoken in this room. I go back to 1996 on the 20th of September when the then Her Majesty Queen Fabiola spoke right here. Okay, and since that time we've never had a Belgian speak in this Hall of Fame. So my congratulations and deep thanks to you.
Okay, there is one thing you should know. Belgium is a kingdom. And I am very loyal to the royal family in Belgium. So when you say this, it's very emotional to me because we loved Queen Fabiola and King Baudouin so much. King Baudouin was our king, two kings away, because after him it was King Albert II and now we have King Philip. So thank you for mentioning that, because the day that King Baudouin died, I remember it's like a little more than 20 years ago, the whole country was in deep grief, exactly the same as King Bumibon. Because King Baudouin and King Bumibon were very close friends, and they even look a little bit alike, you see? And you know, I had, some years ago, I had a dinner in Meissot with Princess Sirikit. And, not Queen Sirikit, Princess Sirintoon. Princess Sirintoon. And she told me stories about the Belgian royal family. Because she calls Queen Fabiola her auntie, and King Baudouin was her uncle. So thank you for saying that, because it's really very, very important.
And that also underscores the value that Belgium has brought to Assumption University. We are the only university in the kingdom with very strong relations, the strongest, I would say. For example, Queen Fabiola has been to this campus twice. 1996 to receive the Doctor Honoris Causa posthumously on behalf of King Baudouin right here. And secondly, she came here in 1998, here again on the 20th of October. She always chose those dates around about just after the middle of the month to visit Thailand, but she came here for a holy mass at the chapel, which Ehsan will show you in a few moments. So really, when I say thank you to my brother Francis, it is from the depths of my heart. Okay, thank you so much. Okay. What I'm going to do is this. We are going to do a group picture.